One of the themes that came up in our panel today is something that's really painful and difficult for a lot of people. We get into this place where we're in pain and we're feeling overwhelmed or lost or not good enough. And then we start saying, but I shouldn't feel this because I have all these good things. I shouldn't feel this because, shouldn't be scared because I'm actually safe and, you know, I'm being ridiculous. And I think one of the keys to this is to recognize that emotions don't cancel each other out. We can be scared and we can feel safe at the very same time. Yeah, I'm grateful that I have this house to live in and people that love me. That doesn't mean I can't also be overwhelmed or scared. I feel happy about this. That doesn't mean I can't also feel sad at the same time about other things. And so as we start to really embrace the complexity of our own emotional experience and honor what is, we can start to learn and grow. Here's some insights.
So what I also wanted to talk about is we're talking about normaling the conversation, right? Creating these spaces where you can talk about mental health and making mental health not scary and shattering the illusion. And I think a large part of that is normalizing feelings that maybe we don't like feeling. And I want to ask Clayton your perspective on that. How can we talk about feelings that might be uncomfortable for us that people try to avoid? And how can we embrace those? That was the title of the first panel that we had this morning was embrace your all your emotions. So I'd love to hear your opinion on that.
Well, I would say if you want to start having that conversation with somebody, it has to start coming from you. Because if you are willing to open up and be vulnerable, I think that will trigger something in the person you're talking to or in others to feel that you can hold that safe space to, you know, let them be open and vulnerable. So I think, first of all, that starts with you. And you can take that anywhere you go. And it's important for me, especially to, there's like a lot of small talk, you know, hey, how's it going? Good. How are you? Okay. Like kind of move on during your day. Or like, you know, what shows you watch on Netflix? Oh, did you see, you know, whatever latest celebrity gossip, it doesn't really matter. But that stuff that, you know, doesn't have that much depth to it. But if you're willing to take that conversation to another level, like, you know, how are you actually doing? You know, how is it going since your, you know, parents got divorced? How's it going since your dad passed away? You know, things like that. And you start by opening up yourself. I think that makes people feel way more comfortable opening up within themselves. And then that can kind of spread. You know, it only takes one conversation with one person. And then maybe it's like, okay, that person feels more comfortable to be open and vulnerable because they understand that they're not going through the struggle alone, that these feelings that they're having aren't necessarily bad. It's just something that everyone goes through and it should be normalized. So I think going back to my main point, it kind of starts with you.
Yeah, that was a great answer. Absolutely. Sophie or Ryan, do you have anything that you want to add?
Yeah, I'd love to jump in and say, I think it's super important that the way we normalize mental health is by changing the language we use to talk about it. So we know physical health is normalized. Like, no one has a problem saying, I went to the orthodontist or I broke my ankle. So why is it different saying I have anxiety or I went to my psychiatrist? It's because of the language that we use to talk about it. So we say things like mental health issues and mental health problems. And when we use these words, issues and problems, they're very negative. They have a negative connotation and that creates stigma. And people say it all the time, even mental health advocates say mental health issues, mental health problems. And what's important to note is that when we talk about physical health, we don't say like someone has a problem with cancer or an issue with diabetes. We just say what it is. We use very neutral language. And so I think it's really important for us to normalize the conversation by using neutral language when we talk about mental health. So saying things like mental illness or mental health challenge or mental health concern is a lot more neutral than saying things like issues or problems or someone suffers from anxiety, someone struggles with depression. If you replace those words, struggle and suffer, with someone experiences depression or someone was diagnosed with anxiety, I think it really opens up the conversation and makes it a lot more accessible to more people.
That's a great answer. Thank you so much for saying that. Someone needed to say it. I'm glad it was you. And that's a great technique that we can use in everyday language. It's like, we don't necessarily, I mean, it's great when we stand up in front of people and we give a presentation, but these are little things that we can do every day that make the communication surrounding mental health so much more natural and so much more effective. Ryan, do you have any opinions on communication?
Yeah, so like, as I've been saying, I try to educate people and like just trying to normalize it that way. But even for me, like if someone like is trying to talk to me and ask me how I'm really feeling, I start like getting really nervous. I start breaking down or something because like, you know, it's scary even for me to talk about it because I feel like it's just not normalized like that yet. And I really like what Sophie's saying. I'll like take that into account of my life now because that's actually a good point. But yeah, I definitely think that when you're talking to someone, definitely use certain terms that won't be, you know, triggering or make others upset, just like the whole mental health issues and like kind of changing that. But also make sure you're talking to someone that, you know, you care about. Or maybe if like when you're talking to them, like there has to be like empathy in between it, so then like is more understanding, because I know that sometimes when I talk to people, what happens, it's kind of becomes like more of a therapy session. And I know some people might like that. I know some people might hate it. So it's kind of just having to find that whole entire balance of it all. Of, you know, do I just listen or do I try to help them like solve a little certain problem they may have? Like, if there's all these different components into trying to change how to have a conversation about it or something like that. If you're like actually talking to someone with mental health thing. Sorry, I forgot what the term I should use. Or if, you know, you're just talking to someone trying to help them understand it and like using better terms to use it.
Great. Thank you, Ryan.
And just really quickly, something based on what Ryan said, which is the idea of do I listen or do I try to help and problem solve? And what I like to talk about a lot is this idea that you need to meet them before you move them. So a lot of the time, what we do when we're trying to help someone is we try to fix and problem solve and move them to a better situation. And that's because we don't like dealing with negative emotions. That's not because they don't like dealing with negative emotions. And so it's really important to meet them where they are. So saying things like, this must be really hard for you, or I'm so sorry you're dealing with this, instead of saying, you're going to get over this, just relax, you're fine. We don't want to move them. We want to meet them where they are in their emotional state so that they can learn to trust us and have a more open conversation.